Oh, Oh, of you who took a weekend off or a week off after Easter, you missed a wonderful time of worship, a time of togetherness. I want to read from the Psalm 77 in light of this special service we have today of Holocaust Remembrance Day. I don't know how many churches across America are recognizing Holocaust Remembrance Day and doing what we're doing here, but we're certainly going to remember Israel. We're going to remember the Jews and all those that perished during that dark time of human history. But I have Psalm 77 I was thinking about this week and just reading this and praying through this, and I think it has application to what we're celebrating today. It says this: I cried out to God for help. I cried out to God to hear me when I was in distress. I sought the Lord. At night I stretched out my untiring hands, and my soul refused to be comforted. I remembered you, O God, and I groaned. I mused, and my spirit grew faint. You kept my eyes from closing. I was too troubled to speak. I thought about the former days, the days of long ago. I remember my songs in the night. My heart mused, and my spirit inquired, will the Lord reject me forever? Will he never again show his favor upon us? Has his unfailing love vanished forever? Has his promise failed for all time? Has God forgotten to be merciful? Has he in anger withheld his compassion? Then I thought this: to this I will appeal, the years of the right hand of the Most High. I will remember the deeds of the Lord. Yes, I will remember your miracles of long ago. I will meditate on all your works and consider all your mighty deeds. Your ways, O God, are holy. What God is so great as our God? You are the God who performs miracles. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this day that we can come into this church and worship you freely, Lord, without persecution or out fear. But Lord, we also remember the millions who perished during a very dark time of human history. And as the Christian church, we have an obligation to not only recognize those who perished, but also remember their lives and remember what the church should or should have done during that period of time, Lord. We pray for not only those who perished during this dark time of human history, Lord, but we pray for the peace of Jerusalem, Lord, and Israel, Lord, that there would be peace upon all peoples there, Lord God. And we thank you, Lord, that we can come into this church and remember the beacons of hope and light that happened during this very dark time. And we pray, Lord, today on this day of National Remembrance, Holocaust Martyrs Day, Lord, that those who perished did not perish for nothing. We thank you and praise you in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.
You may be seated. Well, as I already indicated to you, today is a special day, Holocaust Remembrance Day. It's celebrated once a year. I have been celebrating this holiday probably for the last decade or so, and usually over the last 5 or 6 years, I've been doing lectures on particular aspects of the Third Reich and National Remembrance Day. So today I hope that you enjoy the slide presentation that we've prepared for you. We'll have a few videos as Rob sets up the screens. We'll have a few short videos, and then I'm going to lecture on Holocaust Remembrance Day. Then I'm going to tell you a very special story about La Chambon, this little French town that was really a tremendous beacon of hope and light during this very dark time. But anyway, welcome. If you're visiting us for the first time, you can fill out one of these Tom's River communication cards, fill out your name, your address, your email address, and you can check on the back whether or not you want to be involved in any of the ministries, and you can put that in the black box on the side. We also have new prayer request cards. You know, you can fill out your name and whatever prayer request you have, and I'll remember to pray for you during the week if you want to fill one of these out, because people come up to me all the time and say, Pastor, pray for this, and I try to remember to pray for it, but unless I have it in my hand, unfortunately, I have so much going on during the week that when I have the card in my hand, I can remember, oh, this person told me to pray for this, and then it reminds me, and I can actually do that. So if you fill out a card, I'll pray for you. If you don't fill out a card and you ask me to pray for you, well, you take your chances with that. Also, there's some note cards out here. We designed these beautiful note cards that you can send in the mail. They're postcards. It says Tom's River Community Church. Just a little note to let you know. I prayed for you today. And then it has on the back, it has a scripture verse that says, where two or three have gathered together in my name, I'm there in the midst. And you can write a little note to somebody that you like and put a stamp on it. There should be some over there. If there's not one over there and you want one, I'll give you one. But everybody loves these, and we've printed up several hundred of them already. And I'm hoping that all those hundreds of notes went out to people to encourage them. So those are out there too. Let me go to the announcements. Very special announcement today. We have Dominic McCoy, who's been here for probably 6 months or so. He's a friend of mine. I've known him for years, him and his family. Dominic is a new member of the Toms River Community Church ushering staff, and he was here bright and early. Dominic, why don't you just stand up so everybody can appreciate you. Dominic, thank you for volunteering to do that. It's wonderful. He was excited to do it, and I was excited to have a friend of mine part of the ushering staff. And he was here bright and early this morning setting up and taking care of everything, and I really appreciate that. I appreciate the ushers because they really keep the sanctuary right. They set up properly. They help us out during the service and after the service. So even a lot of the guys, I even see them once in a while cleaning the dishes back there, you know. So they do a good job. And Don and Jay aren't here today. So that's good. So we're glad to have you, Dominic. We're glad that you joined the ushering staff, and we're glad that your family comes here. So as I said today, I'll be doing the lecture, and then Dr. Kelsey will be preaching next week. And then I'll begin finalizing the sermon series that I was in on the three offices of Jesus Christ. You probably forgot about it by now, but we did do prophet, we did priest, and the last two sermons I'll do are on king. So I'll look at the perspective of king from the Old Testament, and then, of course, the New Testament in the person and work of Jesus Christ. So that'll be coming in a few weeks. And then, of course, Mother's Day, we celebrate the wonderful mothers that we have Sunday, May 14th. And we'll have a special service for you there. I think that those are all the announcements. So why don't we open up our bulletins and we'll go to the unison reading. And once again, the unison reading is themed. It relates to Holocaust Remembrance Day. And this is a beautiful psalm too. The psalms are fantastic. This is Psalm 85. It says this. O God, do not keep silent. Be not quiet, O God. Be not still. See how your enemies are astir, how your foes rear their heads. With cunning they conspire against your people. They plot against those you cherish. Come, they say, let us destroy them as a nation, that the name of Israel be remembered no more. With one mind they plot together. They form an alliance against you. This was written thousands of years before the Holocaust. I mean, it's extraordinary, some of the scriptures that we have. And some of the psalms that we've read are just so appropriate for that time of persecution of God's people. But with that, today is Mission Sunday. Judy, we haven't forgotten you. Why don't you come up, Judy, and you could share with the church what's going on with the missions.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
You know, your house has a lock. And your doors have a lock, and everything is closed up tight. You're safe at night when you leave your house. No one comes, and it's all safe and everything else, and you feel secure that way. The homeless don't have that opportunity. It's very hard to keep a tent safe so no one comes in it. We had an occasion where a tent was taken over by someone, and they refused to leave it. And it was a little strained, a little difficult. There was lots of discussions. There was some anger, no fighting, no anything like that. And eventually the gentleman left the tent and has not returned. So we're able to settle down a little bit in that area. We've had some homeless get jobs. One man in particular is waiting to go into training, and he is very excited about it, and he will do marvelous. They're very lucky that they have him. He's a fine gentleman. Others are working landscaping. Some are doing part-time things, but they try to keep as busy as they can, and they try to get jobs. A lot of people say, oh, they're just drunk, they smoke, they don't do anything. They hang around, they sleep, but they do not do all those things. They work hard at trying to take care of themselves. And if you had to live one day in the woods, you would understand how difficult it is. And they help. They're always here to help me. They carry things, they put things away. We work out there when we're doing a great job of working out there too, because we're getting everything sorted out. We finally have, believe it or not, 3 buckets of crew neck sweatshirts. And they were here and there and there and here, and we were losing sight of them. Now we have them all together. We can walk in there, we can open up the lid and get sweatshirts for the whole world if we needed it, which is great for us. And we'll continue to work there. So I have a great respect, as you know, for the homeless, and I admire them for being able to have a good sense of humor, to laugh, to talk to people, and just to live on their life and still remain living in a tent. Now, as far as clothing, we aren't getting as many people. I've been told that some of them are concerned about coming here, and we will have conversations with them, and some have been visited and talked to and stuff. So we're hoping they return, because they need to know that this is a very safe spot for them. And we need to reassure them of that. But we have a lot of clothes. We work hard with all the clothes that come in every week. We have to come on separate days to sort through them and everything. So I'd like to ask you to cool it for about 1 month of giving us things, unless you have important things for us. You know, shoes and a few things like that. But we have so much trouble trying to get everything done in the sorting, we don't have a lot of time to work on other things, and the clothing are piling up and piling up and piling up. So if you would do that for me, and if you want to donate something, just tell me, you know, and we'll work on it, all right? Thank you so much for all of your help.
All right, well, as you know, we support the church, and when you support the church, it allows us to continue to do all the things that we do. Really a beautiful, this church is a really beautiful example, and I know I've been saying that for years, but you'll be able to read it soon. So we've basically completed, the book is completed, it's in its final stages of sorting out the publication, and then also what I did was I wrote a workbook to go along with the book. So the purpose of the workbook is that when you read the book each chapter, you go to the workbook and you try to answer the questions, and it makes you think theologically. So the purpose of the workbook, if you utilize it properly, when you get done reading the book and then you utilize the workbook, and the workbook is not easy. I didn't dumb it down to make it easy for anybody. I mean, you really have to think these things through. And actually, when I was doing the workbook and trying to answer the questions, I stumped myself a few times, so I had to go back to the book and reference the book to see what I was looking for. But the workbook is really good, because the workbook becomes your own book. So I wrote a theological book on the Christian church, and Christology, and all those things are in those chapters. But then you have a workbook, so you can use what I wrote, think about some of the things that I wrote out. You don't have to agree with all these things that I wrote out, of course not. But then you make the workbook. There's so much room for writing in the workbook. We have extra spaces for you, so you can write notes on it. So you can actually think through each of the chapters and the topics in the workbook and make it your own form of ministry. I mean, you can think through the way ministry should be, the way church should be, you know, your own theology. You know, all the topics are in the book. I mean, I've covered just about everything. So it's really going to be a really interesting thing. I was getting... I got emails from Texas, people in Texas that are unrelated to the church, or keep on asking when the book is going to be coming out. So I let them know that it'll be coming soon. We're just a little behind schedule. We had to make a few adjustments, and working with the publisher with things is not as easy as one would think. But we wanted to get the book right, and it's a theological book. And you know, they have about, I guess there's a 3% error in high-level publishing, which we did, and the type of style that the book was edited in. There's about a 2-3% error in each of the books. So what we did was we went back and tried to correct all those 2-3% errors in the book, and we found a few of them, believe it or not. So we think it's almost right, almost perfect, and then it'll be coming soon. So the church functioning does so much. It does the outreaches. It does the church services. The music. It does the School of Theology on Wednesday nights. It just does so much. So we're very grateful for your support. We're grateful for the tremendous ministries we have at the church, and Judy, of course, leading the the outreach to the displaced and the community is a wonderful thing. So as you support the church, we can continue to do all these things. So we're not going to shake you down for anything. If you want to give, you give. If you don't want to give, you don't give. You know, and I let God take care of all that. So he's been faithful for me for 52 or 53 years. I'm not really sure how many it's been, but it's getting up there now to the point that you start losing track. I'll just say he's been faithful over 50 years. Let's just say that. Even though I'm not 50 yet. But anyway, let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this beautiful day. We're so excited that we can be in church today and just remember this special day and remember the lives of those that perish, Lord, but yet find great hope in that and great comfort in knowing that you're in control of all things, oh God. And we thank you for today. We ask you that you bless the offering and bless those that are here today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. We're going to watch a short video. Just a first. Just the back lights off, please.
Les enfants frappent à nos portes, sans parents, sans toi pour les protéger. Et ils nous disent seulement, aidez-moi.
Mais on nous avait dit 3 ou 4.
Nous ne connaissons pas de juifs ici.
Arrête de faire le singe sur une photo d'identité. Parfait, au suivant.
À partir de maintenant, tu vas t'appeler...
Lisa Blumenthal.
Non. Maintenant, tu t'appelleras Lisa Mercier.
N'oublie pas la répétition ça au collège.
Hein? Mon Dieu, mais ils veulent m'apprendre.
On a fait notre part, maintenant il faut qu'on arrête.
C'est vrai. Nous, ces gosses, on les aime bien. On les a nourris, logés. Mais c'est devenu trop dangereux.
Donc on n'a pas tout donné, on n'a rien donné.
Oui, non, monsieur le pasteur, un homme comme vous ne ment pas.
Je ne sais pas qui est juif ou qui n'est pas. C'est une question que je ne pose jamais sur quelqu'un. Ça, c'est la vérité.
Cette vérité peut réduire votre village en cendres.
Réveille-toi, les Allemands. Cours avec Kirtonel, vite, vite. Ils sont là.
So you just saw a little movie snip entitled Weapons of the Spirit, and it has to do with the story of La Chambon, which we'll discuss. Now, I'm not, I don't expect you to understand everything that went on in that short little video. It was a little disjointed and it was put together. But today we remember the Holocaust. Holocaust Remembrance Day in memory of 6 million Jews that perished and probably another 3 or 4 million other people perished in this particular Holocaust Day. There they have the patch that was worn by many of the Jews to signify them as Jews, and that identification was also on many of the buildings that they had, the churches or the synagogues rather, and the businesses that they had. But it's important that we share this so the world will. Never forget the tragedy
that we allow to go on. When I met my wife and found out that she was Jewish, probably about a year or so into knowing her, I asked her, you know, about her family, and her family was in the concentration camps. Her grandmother still has the markings of the concentration camps, and many of her family that's still in Israel were in the concentration camps. And some perished and some lived. Look at this. If we held a moment of silence for every victim of the Holocaust, we would be silent for 11 and a half years. Today is Holocaust Memorial Day. Some call it Holocaust Martyrs Day. It says, free men and women denounce these vile crimes. And when this world struggle ends with the enthronement of human rights, racial persecution will be ended, Winston Churchill. Imagine this. Imagine you are only allowed one bag for all your possessions. A soldier holding a rifle orders you to quickly board a cattle car. The door locks and the train pulls out slowly. You have no idea where you're going or where the train will stop. This is what they experienced in a matter of moments. Elie Wiesel, I believe he just died a few months ago. He wrote the book entitled Night. I remember as a 12-year-old boy, I read that in school. It was a very thin book. It's only about 98 pages long, but it's Elie Wiesel's experience in the concentration camp. And it was probably the only book I ever read as a child, believe it or not, but I never forgot it. It left such an impression. And he wrote this, for the dead and the living, we must bear witness of what happened. And I don't know many churches that are probably doing something like this. It's probably far too radical for pastors to maybe preach these things and share these things. But I think we have an obligation to bring this forth to the church and bring this forth to the Christian community. We have a black eye as a Christian church for what we allow to happen. And this is, of course, the railroad tracks leading those cattle cars that those families loaded onto. The train tracks went right into the death camps, and I believe that that's Auschwitz. For there has been no evil unleashed in the world such as that done to the Jewish people, exterminated like vermin just for the crime of being Jews. They were treated like that. The president, this was a presidential proclamation, I believe it was from the last president. It was a statement by the president on International Holocaust Remembrance Day, where all around the world people are celebrating and remembering the Holocaust. It is with a heavy heart and somber mind that we remember and honor the victims, survivors, heroes of the Holocaust. It is impossible to fully fathom the depravity and the horror inflicted on innocent people by Nazi terror. Yet we know that in the darkest hours of humanity, light shines the brightest. And you'll see that today. As we remember those who died, we are deeply grateful to those who risked their lives to save the innocent. In the name of the perished, I pledge to do everything in my power throughout my presidency and my life to ensure that the forces of evil never again defeat the powers of good. Together, we will make love and tolerance prevalent throughout the world. They were required to make these Jewish patches that say Jude on it. And they were required to put them on themselves. I tried not to bring any graphic pictures knowing that it's Sunday morning. But these are men at the concentration camps. And these are the children at the concentration camps. Probably all of which have perished. I brought just one picture of just eyeglasses. They took everything from these people. They took all their clothes. They recycled all their clothes. They took their glasses. They took all their jewelry. They took all their fillings and their teeth out. And there were piles and piles and piles of shoes, clothes, belts, eyeglasses. This happened 75 years ago. It didn't happen thousands of years ago or hundreds of years ago. This happened in many of people's lifetimes that we know. I broke this scale, the Holocaust deaths down. You'll see that, unfortunately, the Polish people, the Polish Jews, and the Ukrainians, where my wife is from, were the most persecuted and most the most deaths. Poland was, I've heard reports that the roads were just colored in red blood in Poland. So much mass, so much death. And the Ukraine, my wife would tell me as a little girl, she was the only Jew in the school, and she wouldn't let on to anybody that she was Jewish. She was afraid that if they found out she was Jewish, that she would be persecuted, even then, growing up. And the teacher got wind that she was Jewish, and the teacher was very mean to her, would hit her, would make her stay after school, would give her detention, would tell her that you don't belong in the school with us. And this was happened to my wife as a little girl. And finally, her family had to flee the Ukraine because they were Jewish, of course, and the government was beginning to seize their property and seize their businesses. So they actually left the Ukraine with no money at all. And her father was one of the most wealthy men in all of the Ukraine. He wasn't affluent. He was one of the richest men in the country. And they had to leave basically with the clothes on their back. That's it. And they fled to Europe. Picture of children. Cute little boys. This is how many death camps were in Poland. You know, we only know about the big ones, we hear about the big ones, but look at how many death camps were in Poland. I mean, it's extraordinary. The death. I got this picture because I think this is from Schindler's List, and I thought it was just a beautiful picture with the little girl, the little Jewish girl, just not knowing what's going on, dressed in her beautiful little coat, not knowing that in all likelihood she was probably going to die very shortly. Is one of the hats that they had to wear. You know, they had a horrible thing about the whole Third Reich and the whole regime is that it was financed by the Jews. Do you know, you probably don't know this, that when they had to board the trains, the Germans made the Jews buy tickets to get on the railroad cars to go to the death camps. They financed their own death. This is one of the memorials. I thought this was an extraordinary memorial. Just has thousands of faces in steel. And just it's like a turret or a gully, because they would make the Jews dig their own gullies out. And they would make them get in and they would shoot them. And they would line them up and they would shoot another row and line them on top. And this is how the people are on top of one another. This is what this memorial signifies. The Barman Declaration, and this was, I would say, a little bit of a spark, a little bit of a light. Unfortunately, the Confessing Church in Germany did not do enough. They were split, and there was only a few pastors, Bonhoeffer, Barth, and a few other pastors that really stood up against the Nazi regime to the detriment of themselves and their family. But Karl Barth wrote, the great Swiss theologian, he wrote this: "We repudiate the false teaching that the church can turn over the form of her message and ordinances at will or according to some dominant ideological and political conviction." And what happened was this: Hitler was very close with not only the Catholic Church, but also the German Church, the German Christian Church. And he was exercising control in a way over the churches, and the churches were complicit in Hitler handling the churches, and he was using the churches for political and ideological reasons. A few pastors, just a very small handful of pastors, took opposition to that and said, "We will not be part of this regime. We will not be used as political pawns for this madman." And they issued the Barman Declaration, and many of these men that signed the Barman Declaration feared for their life and actually died. Bonhoeffer was one of the men that signed the Barman Declaration. He was the leading. You know, as I study the role of a pastor, it's pathetic. It's actually pathetic, the role that we have today in America and what we do in America today. These are pastors. The pastor you'll meet later, Karl Barth, Dietrich Bonhoeffer, Andrei Trukhmay, these are pastors that risked their lives for the congregation and for the people and would preach what they had to preach, whether they were in fear of death or not. Not this nonsense that's going on in America today. Look what Bonhoeffer said, Pastor Bonhoeffer. "If I sit next to a madman as he drives the car into a group of innocent bystanders. I can't, as a Christian, simply wait for the catastrophe, then comfort the wounded and bury the dead. I must try to wrestle the steering wheel out of the hands of the driver. Silence in the face of evil is evil itself. God will not hold us guiltless. Not to speak is to speak. Not to act is to act. And unfortunately, that's what you had with the majority of the Christian, German Christians and Christians in Belgium and France and Poland and many of the other places. But we get to this little bright light, La Chambonne, this little town in France. It's in a beautiful hill country, and I'm going to step up here and share with you a little bit about the story of La Chambonne. Let me read for you. If you go to your back of your bulletin, I'm going to read for you just one scripture that I think encapsulates what I'll be sharing with you today. La Chambonne, Matthew chapter 25, at verses 37 to 40. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or need clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you? The king will reply, truly I tell you, whatever you did for the one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me. I'm going to share with you the story of La Chambonne. The story of La Chambonne. During the reign of terror of the Nazi regime, a small French town stood as a beacon of light and hope for not only the Jews, but the world. This little village of La Chambonne was the safest place in Europe for the Jews. The people of La Chambonne had to trust their neighbors, knowing that if just one person gave away the secret, the entire community could die. It was reported that very few Jews, for many years, people thought that not one Jew perished in all of La Chambonne. But I found that there was a few that did perish. Approximately five did perish. But it's reported that only a few Jews were taken by the Nazis. This town tells a story of a conspiracy of goodness. When an entire town band together in one mind, one spirit, and one objective, to do for others as they would do for themselves. This beautiful town was just a small town, small village in a hill with a beautiful forest. But these people, these villagers of this La Chambonne, they were committed to standing against evil without ever firing a shot. But they stood in solidarity together as a community, then together in humanity for the preservation of life. Why are there not more stories of people, whether German or not, standing against evil during this time? There's so few stories. It raised a very troubling theological question for me. I thought about this all week. I talked with my wife about it. See, this is the scenario that many of the German people were put in, many of the German Christians and many of the people in Europe. Either you kill them or we will kill you. It doesn't leave you much of a choice. And I thought about this. Many of Germany, many of the people, they went along with this propaganda and this program of anti-Semitism, separation, then annihilation. They were silently complicit in the Third Reich. And I thought to myself this, that people would have had to stand up. And when confronted with the question of either you kill them or we kill you, the decision would have to be made, you kill us. I refuse to kill them. It's a tremendous choice to be made, that you would have to give your life for those people, those others. And your family may perish, but that decision would have to be made in order to stop the cycle of violence and evil. If people would have stood up and said, no, I will die in their stead. No, I will die in their stead. It could have perpetuated goodness in this evil and stopped this evil, but people didn't say that. People said, I'll kill them rather than my life being lost. a bunch of cowards. But the small French town, led by this very obscure pastor, and the people of the town stood in the face of evil, facing death themselves, and said, "We will not take part of this madness." In occupied France, French collaborators. You see a picture of France. These are all the different towns that are broken down. La Chambonne is right here, the beacon of hope and light. All these other places didn't make the decision that La Chambonne made. For if they made the decision of La Chambonne, we would see this town in red, this town in red, this town in red, this town in red, taking a stand against the Nazi regime, saying, "No, we won't take part of this. We'll die rather than they." But only La Chambonne stood. In occupied France, French collaborators, the French people, French Christians, delivered about 100,000 Jews, men, women, and children, to the death camps, and only 3,000 survived. La Chambonne, what a beautiful place. This little town of La Chambonne took in and saved as many Jews, actually more Jews were saved than their whole population. The population was roughly around 5,000 people. They saved far more than 5,000 Jews. Ordinary people did extraordinary things in protecting, feeding those displaced. Sound familiar? Right under the nose of the Nazi regime, the Vichy government, and the Gestapo. They defied the Nazi regime and their own government that was in collusion with the Nazis. So deep was the commitment of these people of La Chambonne, they never turned a single Jew away, not one. The story started on a cold, dark evening during the winter of 1941 with a knock at the door of André Trocmeau, the pastor of La Chambonne. Let's go back to the other picture. Here's the pastor. This is the pastor of the town with his wife. He had a knock on the door one night, and it was a little Jewish girl, and she needed help, and he said, "Come in." The Jewish girl stood at the door, hungry, cold, battered. Pastor Trocmeau invited her in, gave her food, clothes, and a place to sleep. This simple act of kindness led to a chain reaction, a chain of events that saved, protected, and arranged for hundreds, if not thousands, of Jews to escape the rule of the Nazis. This one theologian, this one pastor. Pastor Trocmeau was educated at Union Theological Seminary. Actually, Union Theological Seminary was the same seminary in New York City that Pastor Bonhoeffer went to. And I tried to do a little bit of research, but my understanding of Union Theological Seminary was that Princeton had a break in the faculty, and I think it was in 1930. I had read a book on this early when I went to Princeton, but some of the teachers left and started a seminary in New York, which happened to be Union Theological Seminary. And now Union Theological Seminary is housed at Columbia University. But there was this social awareness that Union had. Bonhoeffer was there. Pastor André Trocmeau was there. So they had this understanding of persecution, they had this understanding of social justice. But maybe even more importantly, the history of La Chambonne is very important. The history of La Chambonne is that it was settled by French Huguenots, and French Huguenots were being persecuted by the Catholics. The French Huguenots were Protestants, and they were being persecuted in history from the Catholics, and they came to La Chambonne to find solace, to find comfort, and to find a place that they could live peacefully. But the town of La Chambonne was mostly French Protestants. They were ancestors of the Huguenots. They were inspired by the writings of John Calvin. They had been persecuted by the Catholics, and many fled into this mountain area of La Chambonne. Pastor Trocmeau showed the people of the village effective and practical ways to resist the regime. He made public demonstrations of resistance. For instance, he would not salute Hitler. He would not do the German salute. He refused to, and the town refused to salute this madman or his henchmen. They would not pledge unconditional obedience to the head of the state. They would not pledge obedience to the Vichy government, which was nothing more than the Nazi regime put into France. They would not ring the bell at certain times that they were supposed to ring the bell. They were supposed to ring the bell when the regime said to ring the bell to celebrate a certain event or somebody's death or someone's birthday, one of the leaders of the regime. They refused to ring the church bells for that. Pastor André Trakmé lived out the tenets and teachings of Jesus Christ. In his Bible, and we'll see his Bible later on, it said this: happy are those hungry and thirsty for justice, for they will be satisfied. One of the greatest quotes that came out of Pastor Trakmé when the Germans, you saw the little clip in that movie that I showed you, the little clip of the movie. When the Germans and the Gestapo came to the pastor, they knew that he couldn't lie or would not lie. And basically he said, we know you have Jews here. We know they're here or in the mountains, and we know you know where they are. And his response was this. What a brilliant response. When the party asked for all the Jews in the town, Pastor Trakmé stood up and said to them, we do not know what a Jew is. We know only men. And to me, that quote is what saved the Jews' lives that he protected. There's a picture of the church, just a little simple church. But the resistance was led by the spirit from this little church and from the pulpit of this church. Pastor Trakmé delivered a sermon entitled Weapons of the Spirit. He preached this on August 16th, 1942. He delivered a sermon stating that the Christian church must kneel down and ask God to forgive its present failings and cowardice that they didn't stand up to the Nazi regime. And he was standing up to the Nazi regime, but he preached a sermon saying that churches all over Europe, all over Germany, should stand up against this horrible activity that the Third Reich is doing. And I have for you a clip. It's 56 seconds. It's Pastor Trakmé's daughter reading the words that he delivered in his sermon. And you'll see a picture of the actual pulpit that Pastor André Trakmé preached from. Rob, if we could run that.
France signed the armistice with Nazi Germany on June 22nd, 1940. The next day was a Sunday, and that morning, during services, the two pastors conveyed their position to their congregation. The text of this historic document survives. Pastor Trakmé's daughter repeats the words of people who practiced what they preached.
The duty of Christians is to resist the violence that will be brought to bear on their consciences through the weapons of the Spirit. We will resist whenever our adversaries will demand of us obedience contrary to the orders of the gospel. We will do so without fear, but also without pride and without hate.
That was the words spoken from that pulpit on August 1942. Even the Reformed Church called Pastor Trakmé and said, stop aiding the Jews. His own church, the elders in his church, the hires up in the Reformed Church said, stop aiding the Jews. And what was his response? Of course it was, no. He said, these people came here for shelter and help. I am their shepherd. A shepherd does not forsake his flock. I do not know what a Jew is. I only know human beings. Summer 1942, government buses arrived at La Chambonne. Nazi buses arrived. They were going to collect all the Jews that they knew were there, hiding in the town, hiding in the woods, the forest, and they were going to deport them. When the Nazis came, many of the children would run into the forest. And when the Nazis left, they would sing a song, the villagers would sing a song, and then the children would hear the song being sang, and the children would come out from the forest. As soon as the soldiers left, we would go into the forest and sing a song. When they heard this, the Jews knew it, and it was safe for them to come out. The bus has left La Chambonne empty. Eventually, Pastor Trocmé was arrested by the SS along with many of his associates, and many of those were sent to a concentration camp. Pastor Trocmé was not sent to a concentration camp, but he refused to sign a commitment to fellow government orders pledging allegiance to the government. Others in this particular group of resistance were actually killed in the concentration camps. Pastor Trocmé actually was eventually released, and then he went into hiding. But here you have, he is the pastor of La Chambonne. Trocmé hid the first Jew and encouraged the town to aid the Jews as well. What they were doing was actually, they were hiding a lot of these children in plain sight. You saw in the movie clip that the man was telling the girl to change her name from Lisa Blumenthal to Lisa Massey. Well, they would adopt the children, and they would give them new names, and then they would give them new identities. And actually, the doctor of the town with the pastor's cousin were actually forging the documents to give them new identities. So that's how they were hiding these Jews in plain sight, many of them. And that's how they were able to save their lives. But actually, the doctor was sent to a concentration camp when they found out what he was doing. And also, Pastor Trocmé's cousin was also sent to a death camp, and both of them perished in the death camp. The Reformed Church asked Trocmé to stop aiding the Jews, but he refused. The Vichy government, which was then the puppet of the Nazi regime, then requested Trocmé and his followers to stop, but they refused. They refused at every stop. They gave the Jews fake IDs and ration cards. The town educated the Jewish children. Not one Jew hidden in the town was taken by the Nazis. That's actually not correct. There were five that I was able to distill. There was five. The Nazis raided a school, and there were 18 children in the school, five of which were Jewish. But they took all the 18. They took actually the teacher, which was André Trocmé's cousin, and also the doctor, and they took them all off to death camps, and they all perished in the death camps. So there was a price that was paid by the town. But from what I can count, from the research that I did, only five Jews were lost, in addition to the other 13 children in the classroom, the pastor's cousin, and also the doctor. And many of the Jews were taken to French towns and villages over the Swiss border for safety. This was the secretary. I think she was the pastor's secretary, Pastor Trocmé's secretary, and this is what she said. "You don't have to be a hero to do your human duty. I am afraid of nobody and would ever help other people, because who's a hero? I was not. I was just an ordinary housewife and secretary." This was an award that was given to, it's called the Righteous, let me read this for you. Righteous Among Nations. This is an award given from the Holocaust Remembrance Organization to those people that, Schindler was given the same award, those that helped the Jews during this regime. So my understanding is they were awarding this to Pastor Trocmé, and Pastor Trocmé refused. He said, "I did nothing but my job. I did nothing but preach the gospel and act out the gospel." He says the people that really deserve this are the town. So they awarded this award to the whole town of La Chambonne. The town was awarded Righteous Among the Nations for their acts of heroism during the Holocaust, where the people rallied around. Trocmé's theology was that according to the scripture, the Jews are God's chosen people and the apple of God's eye. He knew that Jesus was Jewish and the Jewish disciples were Jewish and all of Jesus' followers were Jewish. How could a Christian ever persecute a Jew, he thought. This was contrary to everything he understood about scripture. He also believed that when Jesus commanded you to love your neighbor, that it requires Christians to love and care for Jews, even if they didn't believe or accept Jesus Christ as the Messiah. The town of La Chambonne. He said this, the pastor, look for hard ways. Look hard for ways to make little moves against destructiveness. What he did wasn't extraordinary. It was simple. He was helping somebody that was in need, and yet it led to this tremendous resistance and revolt that saved so many people's lives and really was just a beautiful beacon of hope. It was a picture of the gospel in action during a very difficult time. So the purpose of this is to not stir up bad memories or guilt, but for us to remember what happened in the 1930s and 1940s, how these people were just systematically persecuted for what they believed and who and what they were. And it goes to show that the Christians must never be silent. Even in the face of these terrible things, we must never be silent, and we must never be complicit in such horrible acts, because it could happen again. If the Christians sit back and don't voice their opinion, don't voice resistance to horrible things that happen, these things all could happen again. And it may come down to your life or the life of another. And what did Jesus say? It's no greater gift hath no man than to lay his life down for that of another. That was not done in Nazi Germany, and it wasn't done in many of the countries in Europe during this very dark time. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this time together that we can look at these slides and think for a moment of what transpired years ago, Lord. That we remember these things, that we talk about these things so they would never happen again. And we pray, Lord, that the Christian church in America would wake up to its role. We pray that the American church would wake up to its calling, Lord, that it be a beacon of hope and light, that it perpetuate the kingdom of heaven principles, not its own theology. We thank you for this day. We thank you for the people. We pray for Israel. We pray for all those who perished during this very dark time of human history. We thank you and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
My hope and stay.
we're going over today. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, hope, and happiness every day of your life. God bless you all. Have a wonderful day.